doctor is not going to aid her if she's unable to understand what her problem is. You should treat her. If you know that there is a female doctor, you're a male doctor now, right? If you know there's a female doctor who can aid this person, this female, you should give her number. Sorry, sister, there's a female doctor out there. Go to him. No, go to her. Naam, ya Ahmed. Ahsan Allah alaik, very good question. Yes, it is. It's preferable to go to a female doctor even though she's a non-Muslim. Even though she's a non-Muslim. And that is more preferred than going to a Muslim doctor, male doctor. Is waiting a while after the Maghrib, adhan, to iftar an innovation? Should one iftar as soon as they hear the adhan? To iftar as soon as the adhan is pronounced is the sunnah. Is the sunnah. And one should not delay it. Is it an innovation to delay it? This question, I'm going to ask one of the brothers to clarify. Whoever answers the question correctly will be gifted. Jazakallah khair, that's the answer. If you delay it, believing that there is more reward in delaying it, you knew the answer, but you sort of used a different term. If you delayed it due to this, believing that there is a reward, then you are committing an innovation. But if you delay it out of just delayness, then there's no problem, but you are going against the sunnah, you can have, inshallah, a free book from the library. Jazakallah khair. This is one of the innovations of our time, where the mystic Sufis are generally sort of applying in their worship. And if you see the elites, who are called the hoo-hoo clans. Now, these people will sit down in a place of darkness or isolation for some period of time, and they believe that they are traveling to the solar system and beyond. They become astrologists, they become astronauts, they become cosmologists, they become balutagists, and then they start traveling to outer space. Now, and then they claim after that, that حَدَّثَنِي قَلْبِي عَنْ رَبِّي. After all this traveling, they say, my heart has spoken to me in regards of your Lord. In other words, your Lord, my Lord, has directly spoken to my heart and gave me revelation. This is known as the mystic elite Sufis. This is one of the worst of evils amongst innovations that we are currently, at the moment, experiencing. Now, briefly, the Sufis, before you reach that level, there are three categories of Sufism, which is commonly known amongst the Sufis themselves. The first category is, when you first initiate with them, it is all haram, brothers and sisters, all haram. It goes all against the sunnah. And there is no proof whatsoever for what they do. No proof. Instead, there's a lot of evil, kufr and shirk in it. You know, they have actually united and gathered everything in one. They start off by saying, when you first initiate, that you are allowed to say, La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah, you know, in the sittings and so forth. When you've reached that level and passed that level, you get to the second category, the more higher now, higher. It's called the higher class category. This is the general class, now they're on the medium class. The medium class, you are allowed to say, you've gone beyond the La ilaha illallah one, you say now, Allah, 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 Allah. This is the reality now. This is what they do. They sit down and say, Allah, 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 100 miles per hour. Now when you finish that level, you get more elite. You become more sort of spiritual. And it's called the elite stage, where only little reach it. It's called the mystic elites. And they start saying, instead of Allah, who, 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 who. And this is the reality of the Sufis. This is not a myth. It is the actual, genuine fact. This is the way they actually perform it. And then beyond that, they go to the astro travel, which is in their rooms, which is known as al-kashf. And there, the Almighty Lord, to what they believe, what they claim, their evil belief, unveils himself to them and speaks directly to them. Now, there are the elite Sufis who they believe in something called the Qutb. And the Qutb is a person who, to their belief again, sallallahu al-afiyah, controls the universe. Now, al-Qutb amongst them are the ones that have reached beyond elite here. And that's where they have said, the verse in the Quran, حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ, until death comes onto you, the certainty comes onto you. They say no, until you have reached a position of eliteness, you do not have to worship Allah no more. The way you worship Allah from there is as we're saying it now. This person to them, they got a pivot, right? A pivot. And everything rotates around the pivot. They say the elite Sufis, they rotate around the earth. The earth is the pivot, and they rotate and they control the earth. This is the elite belief of the mystic Sufis, and this is directly from their mouth and their books, this information. And this is, a'udhu billah, absolute destruction, evil and corruption, where we are all, we should warn against this evil and thus beware of it ourselves. Our Tablighi brothers, our beloved brothers in Islam, we love them for the sake of Allah. They're our brothers, they're good Muslims, they're righteous. The only problem we've got with the Tablighi brothers, not we've got a problem. Look, we are all Tablighi. Tablighi means propagation. Derived from the verb ballagha yuballighu fahuwa tablighun. In reality, we are all propagators of Islam. But one issue that we got to be very careful about when we talk about Islam is that we do not do anything that goes against the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, to restrict 3 days, 40 days is unacceptable because there's no base for it in the sunnah. And we mentioned earlier on that anything that you say is good, getting close to Allah Ta'ala with, is an innovation if there's no base for it. Now, they have not got a base for this. But what they do of their humbleness, their character, their ethics, wallahi, we should learn from them all. They've got extreme humbleness, extreme ethics. The etiquettes is unbelievable. We should learn from their etiquettes of character and akhlaq, because I have not seen anyone like them. However, we do not approve of the knowledge that is given. You know, I'm not saying that it's all false, but sometimes we've got to be very careful that amongst our brothers of Tabligh, we are all Tabligh, inshallah. I don't like using that word and sort of diverting a sect of such caliber. However, they have a problem with knowledge. In other words, they do not teach authenticity. Now, I used to be, when I first started Islam, they're the ones that brought me to Islam, you can say. In alhamdulillah, ba'da Allah Ta'ala. And the thing that I did not like, which is only little amongst what they have, is the situation of knowledge. Like they'll stand me up and say, give bayan. Now, I did not know what bayan was, nor did I know anything about Islam. So how am I going to give something about Islam? I did not know. So the thing that they lack, unfortunately, is the department of knowledge. If they fix this department, wallahi, they'll be one of the greatest group of brothers on the face of this earth. Because they're extremely powerful in their da'wah, but we have a problem, they have a problem with the knowledge side. They do not look at carefully the department of authenticity and weakness. If this gets fixed up and they do it in accordance to the sunnah, Allahu Akbar. I'm not sure what it is called, but it's a piece or pieces of the Quran or verses of the Quran between two leather pieces sewn together, usually put for kids to protect them. Is that an innovation? Absolutely. What this is known to be as an amulet or a talisman. Something that is placed, in Arabic it's known as hijab, which is placed on a body, whether it's a minor or a big person, an older person. They put it on the shoulder or underneath the pillow or on the wall in here in their room in order to prevent evil or to gain benefit. This is absolutely haram. If it's a Quran in the amulet, it's innovation. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam never taught us this. He said instead, every hijab amulet is shirk. Is shirk. This is the actual wording. Every amulet is shirk. Now, to place the Quran in such a sort of talisman in leather, between leather, and place it on yourself. Muhammad did not teach us this. Instead, if you want to be protected from the evil eye, or from any evil, or you want to gain benefit, the best way to do it is recite the Quran over this person. Not to place Quran in any material, and thus place it on yourself or underneath the pillow. If it's other than the Quran, it's shirk. If it's other than the Quran, it's shirk. And many times when you open these amulets, you find inconceivable writings. You do not understand what it is. You find, for example, a square with mathematical symbols there. Some kind of commas and so forth. You would not understand what it is. It's inconceivable. You cannot read it nor understand it. This is ultimate shirk. Unacceptable. And a person who believes in that and does not keep away from that can become a mushrik. So be extremely careful. Because one of the categories of Tawheed is Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. To unite Allah Ta'ala and Lordship. And that means to unite Him, meaning that you believe that only Allah Ta'ala is the master of the universe, that controls everything in the universe. So if you give that created thing, that object on you, the same level of Allah Ta'ala, you are actually saying that this thing has the power to help me. And this is false, obviously. So this is an act of shirk where a person should be far away from. Likewise, the blue beads, al-kharza, that are placed on the child for the prevention of the evil eye. This is likewise shirk. You are not allowed to place anything on your body, nor place on the wall or underneath your pillow or in the car with the intention that you are trying to gain benefit or prevent harm. By doing this, you are committing shirk, so beware. In regards to riding horses, is it a sunnah which Muhammad ﷺ encouraged us to learn how to ride them? Does this include for the woman? Can we learn how to ride horses? The narration is very clear that Muhammad ﷺ advised this beautiful nation, the nation of salvation and successfulness, that to teach your children what? One, horse riding. Two, archery. Three, swimming. Encouraging us to sport, especially sport that puts manhood into the hearts of the men and takes the wimpishness out of the hearts of men. It puts bravery, courage in the heart of a man when a person learns how to horse ride. And I'm pretty sure all those who experience this will understand exactly what I am saying. Are the ladies allowed to horse ride? Yes, they are allowed to horse ride. There is no problem. They are allowed to ride horses if the place equips them, facilitates for them. For example, if there's an area where horse riding is partaken and they go to that area and there are no men there, then yes, there is no problem whatsoever for a lady to learn how to ride a horse. I actually encourage the husbands to teach their wives to horse ride, especially in our generation. It actually trains them and it makes them fit and strong. And a fit and strong lady, woman, is better than a weak lady. Hopefully that question is understood, the answer is understood, inshallah ta'ala. And there is this false belief out there that, especially among the Arab race, I'm not sure about the other races, that they do not allow their daughters to touch a horse, fearing that something may occur while she is riding. This is absolute ignorance, which Islam rejects. And this is a false belief. And I'm pretty sure those who understand the situation know what I am talking about. Teach them, even though they are children, whether they are males or females, teach them horse riding, teach them archery, even the ladies, and teach them how to swim. Go out for a jog with them. Train them. Go for long walks. Go out to the bushwalk. Take the children, take your wife. Go out. Muhammad used to race his wife Aisha.